Morning. Welcome to St. Andrew Stittsville. We are so pleased you're with us today. And welcome to St. Columbia, our sort of sister church in Quebec, joining us as well. My name is Frank Gillen. I'm the clerk at session here. And at the organ today is Gloria Jean Nagy. She's going to be instrumental, no pun intended, in helping me guide through the service. So hopefully too much pressure there, Gloria. Good. Pastor is not here today. He is with Gracefield Camp, celebrating their 60th anniversary. And if you've never been to Gracefield, it's a must go. I was there as a kid, and of course, as I grew up, not matured, but grew up, I would go to Gracefield as well. And it's a real, real treasure for the Presbyterian Church in Canada to have such a campsite. And it goes right through the, Canada Church goes right through it. So we could have lots of people coming through the camp, but it's a fabulous place, and that's where he is. Other than that, I don't have any other announcements, so we'll prepare my mind for service, and we'll do the call to worship. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises. Let the sea roar and all that fills it, the world and those who live in it. Let the floods clap their hands. Let the hills sing together for joy. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Let us worship God. Today's service is going to be built around hymns. And I'm going to tell a story about the hymn in relation to the Bible as well. And our first hymn is All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. Be seated. The hymn we just sung in relation to the Bible. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things for thy pleasure. They are and were created. This is often called the national hymn of Christendom, It first appeared in November 1779 issue of the Gospel magazine. It has been translated to almost every language where Christianity is known. One writer has said, "So long as there are Christians on earth, it will continue to be sung, and after that, in heaven." It was written by Edward Perronet, a young Anglican minister who was very critical of the communion of the church and threw himself into the evangelistic efforts of the Wesleys. He was often persecuted for his beliefs. On one occasion, John Wesley announced that Edward would preach at the next service. Being 18 years old, Wesley Jr., he refused to preach in Wesley's presence. Not wishing to have public conflict with Wesley, he mounted the pulpit and explained that he had not agreed to preach, but would deliver the greatest sermon ever preached on earth. He read the Sermon on the Mount and sat down. Perronet wrote many hymns, but this is the only one to survive. On one occasion, a missionary to India, E.P. Scott, was waylaid by a murderous group of tribesmen. He took out his violin and began to play and sing this hymn. The tribesmen laid down their spears and were moved to tears. Our next hymn, "All the Way My Savior Leads Me." I'm going to read a bit of an intro first to this one. "The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in their way." This hymn was written by Fanny Crosby, a blind girl, an expression of gratitude after a direct answer to a prayer. She needed $5 and did not know where to get it. So she prayed about it. And in only a few minutes, a stranger came to her door with the exact amount. The only way she could account for it was that God put into the heart of this man to bring her the money. She never wrote a hymn without first praying about it. Other hymns written by her, "Blessed Assurance" and "Rescue the Perishing." So we'll stand and sing "All Hail the Power," "All the Way My Savior Leads Me." Seated. Boy, there's a nice hymn so far. Oof. We only have about 20 to go.
No.
The next hymn, The Old Rugged Cross, from Peter, chapter 2, verse 24. Who his own self bare our sins in his body on the tree, that we, being dead of sin, should live unto righteousness. By those wounds or stripes are healed. This gospel hymn was written by George Bernard in 1913. And this gospel hymn is generally thought to be the most popular of all the 20th century hymns. Following ordination of the Methodist Episcopal Church, George was involved in revival services. One time after turning to Michigan, he went through the trying time when he began to reflect on the significance of the cross and what the Apostle Paul meant when he spoke of the fellowship of Christ's suffering. He became convinced that the cross was the heart of the gospel, and the words of the hymn were put into his head in answer to a prayer. Bernard continued his ministries over 40 years following the writing of this hymn, and at the age of 85, changed his cross for a crown. The Old Rugged Cross. We'll sing verses 1, 3, and 4, and we'll stay seated for this one. Okay.
Just thought you should go.
Okay. We'll do them all. We will sing them all.
Thank you.
Our next hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Scripture reading. A person that hath faith, has friends, must show him or herself friendly. And there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother or a sister. Joseph Scriven was born in 1819, a prosperous parent to a Dublin, in Dublin. At the age of 25, he migrated to Canada. His fiancée had accidentally drowned the night before their wedding, and the influence of the Plymouth Brethren had estranged him from his family. From that time, he developed a different pattern of life, taking the Sermon on the Mount literally. He gave freely of his limited belongings, even sharing clothing from his back. He never refused to help those in need. His manner of life was respected, but he was also considered eccentric. He never intended this hymn to be published. His mother was ill in Dublin, and being unable to see her, he wrote a letter enclosing the words of the text to comfort her. Sometime later, he became ill. A friend who visited him happened to see the words inscribed on a piece of paper near his bed. When he asked if he had written it, he replied, "The Lord and I did it between us." After the death of Joseph Scriven in 1886, also by accidental drowning, the citizens of Port Hope, Ontario, erected a monument on the Port Hope Peterborough Highway with the text and the words, 4 miles north in Bengalis Cemetery, lies the philanthropist, the author of this great masterpiece, written in Port Hope in 1857. We'll stay seated for this one as well.
Thank you.
Now, we're going to do the celebration box. Yes. So I'll bring the celebration box with me. And I just need to get some change in case anybody has a celebration. So, does anybody have a celebration? I have one. And it is the fact that, thank goodness for Gloria on the organ. Thank you so much. I love how you're doing the hymns. And I like the fact that we're doing nice old hymns. We don't always sing these hymns, but it's nice every now and then. So for summer service, I like the hymns. Anybody else have anything? No other celebrations? Well, oh. My presence here. Well, thank you. Well, I'm hope. I'll go do St. Andrew's proud. Thank you very much. Same thing. Geppi, thank you. Ditto. Thank you. Well, it was exciting to be here because I was, these hymns, I must admit, were correlated quite a few years ago. And it was a service we did, I kind of vaguely remember it, but Bea Griffiths, she was a Kirk of Session here and a member of the St. Andrews. And she compiled a lot of these hymns and did all the research. And Bea died very suddenly back June 30th, 2009. And I remember Bea so well because I was, you know, on session, and she was a formidable person to deal with because I can remember the odd tough time getting a cuff in the back of the head because something what I said or did, which is not uncommon. But she was really, really something to be with. And some of you might remember Bea. I do. But I'd like to dedicate this service to Bea because it was such a lovely service when we did this so many years ago. And our next hymn is Rock of Ages. We're going to sing the hymn, and then I'll give you a bit of the background on the hymn itself. So if you wish to stand, you can, as we sing this hymn. Rock of Ages, cleft for thee. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1 and 4. Sometimes the reading here is okay, but I like to read it from the Bible because I find it sometimes, I don't know about you, but I find sometimes I have to think about what I just read and what it meant. So I'm going to take it from my little Bible. Because the wording here is okay, but I found this a little bit easier. Corinthians chapter 10. I want you to remember, my brothers, what happened to our ancestors who followed Moses. They were all under the protection of the cloud and all passed safely through the Red Sea and drank the same spiritual drink. They drank from the spiritual rock that went with them, and that rock was Christ himself. This hymn has been ranked as one of the most popular hymns ever written, but was born from a spirit of passionate controversy, not from a deep personal need. The author, Augustus Toplady, had been converted to Christ as a young boy while visiting Ireland and was attracted to John and Charles Wesley and the Methodists. However, at this time went on, he became a follower of Calvin. He and the Methodists carried on a theological warfare. In 1776, Toplady published this hymn text as a climax to an article attempting to prove his argument that no man through his own efforts could satisfy the eternal justice of Holy God. It was interesting to note he had actually stolen some of the text from a hymn Charles Wesley had written 30 years earlier. Despite the intent behind his text, God in his providence has chosen to preserve this hymn for over 200 years, so that believers of any persuasion can sing this hymn with spiritual blessing.
Thank you.
Our next hymn, oh, I better give a little wording on softly and tenderly. Mark 8, chapter 36 and 37. For what shall it profit a person if they shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul, or what shall a person give in exchange for his soul? Will Thompson was born in Ohio in 1847. He attended the Boston Music School from 1870 to 1873 and studied in Germany. He wrote music for people, and after a successful career in secular music, began to write gospel hymns. He was also known for his singing of songs to people. He was a close personal friend of evangelist D.L. Moody, and this hymn, the one we just sang, was Mona Mooney's favorite. So our next hymn is In the Garden, and we'll sit for this one as well. Now, it is not time for that yet. So, In the Garden, hymn we just sang. When Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord, and he had spoken to, and he had spoken of these things unto her. In 1912, a music publisher asked Austin Miles to write a hymn that would was sympathetic in tone, breathing tenderness into every line. One that would bring hope to the hopeless, rest for the weary, and downy pills for the dying. Miles told of being in his room and having a vision while reading John 20. He watched Mary come into the tomb in the garden, and finding no one there, then she saw Jesus appear to her, and she knelt before him. Miles awakened from this vision and wrote this hymn, the words to this hymn, and later the music. Now, I believe it is time for the next hymn, which is Just As I Am. I'm going to read the little blurb beforehand, then we'll do the hymn. I know I'm going to throw things out of skew. Just As I Am, John 6, chapter 35 to 37. And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth in me shall never thirst. All that the Father has given me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will never turn away. The text for this hymn was born within the soul of an invalid woman who wrote these words out of intense feelings of despair and unselfishness. Charlotte Ellett was born in England in 1789. A young girl, she lived a carefree life as an artist and a humorous first writer. By the time she was 30, her health was failing, and she had been bedridden for the rest of her life. In 1822, a noted Swiss evangelist visited the Ellett home and counseled Charlotte about her spiritual problems. He impressed upon her that you must come as you are, a sinner, to the Lamb of God who takes away your sin. For the rest of her life, she celebrated the anniversary of the day she came to a personal relationship with Christ. It was 14 years before she wrote this hymn, but never forgot the words of her friend. Charlotte wrote 150 hymns and is regarded one of the finest English women hymn writers. After her death, over 1,000 letters were found from individuals telling what this hymn meant to them and meant in their lives. Just as I am. Gee, a beautiful hymn. I'd like that sung at my funeral. That is so nice. Anyway, I'm going to digress. So, now is the offering. If you'd like to bring up the offering.
God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here. above the heavenly host.
Thank you, Lord, for meeting us here today, and thank you for making these tithes and offerings possible to do the work in this church, in our community, and around the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Yep, you may be seated, sorry. I'm going to offer just a little bit of a prayer, and I found it fitting when I was going through my Bible. And I'm just going to make sure. It was Hebrews 10, chapters 25. And I thought it was so fitting, especially in the last year or two, and I thought it'd be nice to read this. Let us not give up the habit of meeting together, as some are doing. Instead, let us encourage one another all the more, since you see that the day of the Lord is coming nearer. Amen and amen. Our next hymn, Blessed Assurance. Thank you. May be seated. We're coming close to the end of the service. This is one of over 8,000 gospel songs written by Fanny Crosby. Can you imagine? A blind poetess. For a period of her life, she wrote three new ones a week. using over 200 pen names beside her own. At times, musician friends would compose the music and ask Fanny for the words, such as was in this case of Blessed Assurance. A close personal friend, Phoebe Knapp, played the melody for Fanny and asked what the tune said. Fanny responded at once, "Why?" "That says, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine." Fanny Crosby died at the age of 95. Engraved on her tombstone are the words, "She hath done what she could," taken from our Lord's words to Mary after she had anointed him with costly perfume. Hebrews 10:22. Let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Now I think we'll do the prayers of the people. It's not going to be the usual prayers. I'm just going to make a general prayer. Let us pray. Dear Lord, as we gather here today, we'd like to pray for the Presbyterian Church in Canada, for all the administration and all the leaders. We also like to pray for our ministers of each church in the Presbyterian Church in Canada as they make decisions, some not so easy, that help and guide our church and benefit the congregations of each church and the congregants in each church. I also like to pray for those who are going through hard times, whether it be illness, a physical, cancers, heart, broken bones. Be with them, Lord, strengthen them, and also encourage them. And I also like to pray for those ministers and for congregants who are traveling the highways and byways of our great country. Be with them, be with their families as they travel. Make them safe, healthy, happy, and sound. And we also shouldn't forget those who really don't have a voice, but they are like family. Our cats and our dogs, gerbils, hamsters, whatever we might have, those that don't have a voice. And those who are, yes, they're pets, but they are considered family. Keep them safe and sound, for we need them, and for some, they are a friend and a guide. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Last hymn. Hard to believe we went through them so quickly. Well, not really. I guess I'm... We're okay. Blessed be the tie that binds. If you want, I'll do the introduction, Gloria. That's okay. John Foss was born to poor parents in Yorkshire, England. At the age of 26, he was ordained a Baptist minister and accepted a call to a small, impoverished congregation at Westgates in northern England. His salary was meager, and his family growing. He received a call to a large, influential church in London. But as the day for departure arrived, his wife broke down, and she said she could not bear to leave. "Nor could I," said the saddened minister. The wagons were unpacked. During one of the ensuing sermons, he shared with this hymn text with his congregation. Fawcett continued his faithful ministry to these humble people for more than 50 years, until a stroke caused his death in 1817. His wife was indeed an example of a spiritual leader who sacrificed ambition, personal gain for Christian devotion. Quite true. The scripture reading was from 1 John chapter 2, verse 10. He that loveth his brother or sister abideth in the light, and there is none occasion of stumbling in him or her. Blessed be the tie that binds. Thank you. I'm going to have a small benediction. I wrote it down because I didn't want to mess it up.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord be with you in your sleep, in your waking, in your work, and in your life.